Amen. Let's stand up and worship Him. What a good day it is to be in the Lord's house and to get to be together with friends and families and the Spirit of God. And you know, there's a lot going on in our world right now. All around the world, people are hurting and suffering and things we can't explain, even across the river. Yesterday and the night before, all the things that happened. And we just trust the Lord in all things and still are able to worship Him, knowing that He's working for our good and His glory and redeeming all things, moving and going to use these things that are happening for your good and His glory. So we just thank God for that. And I'm thankful you're here today. I know there's a lot going on in the world, but you've chosen to put a premium on the worship of God in His house with His people. So I know God's going to move in your life and bless you for that. So let's pray. Then I encourage you, let's sing to the Lord a song from our heart. Father, thank You that, God, You are good. Your mercy endures forever. God, we thank You that You are in control of all things and we trust You fully. God, we don't understand, but Lord, we don't have to because You do. You know. You know Your plans and Your purposes, God. You know why and why not, God. And we trust You fully. God, we do pray for the people in Waverly right now as they have relief efforts going on, as they're still looking for people who are physically lost, God, that they will find these people safe and okay, that there will be people found. And most of all, God, through all of this, people will see their need for You. God, they'll come to know Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. And that we as a church, Lord, will be the hands and feet of Christ to them. We not only pray for them, but the Christians and people in Afghanistan, Father, who are fighting against terrorism, the people all over the world, Lord, right now that are suffering, God. We just thank You, God, that at this moment in our lives, Lord, we are able to live peaceably and worship You, God, and freedom. Lord, we thank You for that. But we don't take it for granted, God. That's why we're here right now, because we just want to worship You, want to give You what You deserve, praise, honor, and glory, and lift You high in this place that people might know that You are God and there is none else. We love You today. Help us sing to You with our hearts now, Jesus. In Your name we pray. Amen. Let's sing together, church.
Here I am before You, falling in love and seeking Your truth, knowing that You're perfect. and I am yours. I am yours, Lord.
Isaiah chapter 43 and verses 1 through 3 says, "But now, O Jacob, listen to the Lord who created you. O Israel, the one who formed you says, 'Do not be afraid, for I have ransomed you. I have called you by name, and you are mine. When you go through the deep waters, I will be with you. When you go through the rivers of difficulty, you will not drown. When you walk through the fire of oppression, you will not be burned. The flames will not consume you, for I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior.'" You know, yesterday, my friend called me at 8 o'clock yesterday morning. And she said, "We're on the countertops and the water's rising." I said, "What can I do?" She said, "Pray." I said, "Yes, ma'am." So we got the prayer chain going. She called me at 10 o'clock last night. She said, "As soon as the prayer started, the water started going down." And she said, "We were able to get out, and we were able to get our cars, and we were able to escape. They lost everything else, but they got their car and they got their life." You know, God is so good. He's our defender. He's our deliverer in times of trouble. You know, when we're his children, we have a special protection from him. And when we're not his children, he still loves us, and his love defends us, and it calls us to himself. So I pray this morning that if you're his child, you praise him. If you're not his child, then you accept him. And that drawing that you feel is in your heart is his love that's drawing you to himself. And listen now as Chris sings, "Your Love Defends Me."
You are my joy, you are my song, you are the well, the one I'm drawing from. You are my refuge, my whole life long. Surely my God is the strength of my soul. Your love defends me, your love defends me. And when I feel like I'm all alone, your love defends me, your love defends me. Night after night, I will remember you're with me in this fight. Although the battle, it rages on, the war is already won. I know the war is already won. Surely my God is the strength of my soul. Defends me, your love defends me. And when I feel like I'm all alone, your love defends me, your love defends me. We sing hallelujah, you're my portion, my salvation. Defends me, your love defends me. And when I feel like I'm all alone, your love defends me, your love defends me. Surely my God is the strength of my soul. Your love defends me, your love defends me. And when I feel like I'm all alone, your love defends me, your love defends me. salvation, my salvation. Surely my God is the strength of my soul. Your love defends me. Your love defends me. And when I feel like I'm all alone, your love defends me. Your love defends me. We say hallelujah. You're my portion, my salvation. Hallelujah. You're my portion, my salvation. Hallelujah. You're my portion, my salvation.
Praise Him this morning if He is your salvation. Amen. This week, the chronological Bible had me reading these joyful messages that Jeremiah wrote to the children of Israel. Gosh, what a bummer, huh? I mean, he just kept telling of all these terrible things that are going to happen. Some of the children had already been carried away. They were already in Babylonia. And then all of a sudden, in the middle of this, around chapter 50, Jeremiah goes, but God is your salvation. Go into the city of Jerusalem and praise Him. He had already told them how they were getting ready to have to be carried away like the rest of them, and the whole city was going to be destroyed. But take a minute and go in and praise God for what He's done. What an act of faith, amen? What a thing to ask of them as Jeremiah, this terrible message that he's been telling them, that all these things are going to come. But yet, the God of Israel, the God of heavenly armies, is still there for you. Go praise Him. What an act of living hope. What an act of things that are going to come that are better. And the terrible week that we've had, and you turn on your phone and you turn on the TV, and it's just death and destruction and terrible, and COVID numbers continue to rise. But we have hope. Praise God for that hope that we have. Let's sing about that living hope that is Christ.
How great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountains I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke Your name into the night. Then through the darkness, Your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished. The end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope.
He is our hope, church. Amen.
Could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me His own. Beautiful Savior, I'm Yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared, the grave has no claim on me.
This is our victory, church. Let's sing it to him.
Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared, the grave has no claim on me. Jesus, yours is the victory.
Grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Oh Lord, you are my living hope.
And let's give him some praise, yeah. Church. Jesus, you are a living hope. There is none like you in all the earth. The earth is full of your glory. As the psalmist David looked under the hills, he said, it's not under the hills that our help comes from, but it is you, the maker of heaven and earth. We thank you in the glorious way you do. Show yourself strong in this place through the power of your spirit, through the worship and through the preaching of the word, that the lost may be saved and the saved may be enamored with you. God, help us fall in love with you more and more every day until we meet you face to face. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's give him another hand clap of praise. Amen. If you got a baby, the nursery's open. And then children's church through second grade, you're welcome to meet in the lobby. Let's get ready for the preached word of God. Amen. Nehemiah chapter number 8. Excited about this morning. I know there's a
lot going on around us. And let me say that the church here and the church at Brewston, First Baptist Church Brewston, we were able to take about 7 loads of things over to Waverly last night. Got there a little after 8 o'clock. It was late because really nobody knew what to do until later on. It was such a travesty, such a hard hit area. You know, 10 foot of water, 9 foot of water in 10 minutes come up. Heard one story of an elderly couple that we met last night was backing out of their driveway, out of their, the water started coming in their carport. By the time they backed the car up 200 yards, the refrigerator had already floated out of the carport. There was no, why didn't they get out? There was no getting out. It was a flash flood, swift water, small ditches, nowhere to go. It's not like Hurricane Katrina or different places where they have lots of time and the water's different. This was very quick, very sudden. And First Baptist Church of Waverly's got infrastructure set up. They're setting up shower trailers and cooking things. They don't have any water right now, so that's a major issue. We took some self-contained porta-johns over there last night, and we took a horse trailer, another trailer, and a bunch of trucks and guys and gals, and took all that we could get. They have 30 to 40 people probably housed at First Baptist. They've got more than that housed at the Church of Christ. In fact, we just got a call a few minutes ago for more porta-johns if we could get a hold of them. They don't have any way to do anything. And all of these people are displaced, and they're going to be displaced. It's not like all their houses didn't have flood insurance, because they won't sell you flood insurance when you live in a floodplain. Seems kind of counterintuitive, doesn't it? They won't get replaced. They won't, unless they get federal money, they won't get any money from their insurance company. So it's really going to be a chance for the Church of Jesus Christ to show up and show out. I am a proponent that the church takes care of people's needs, not the government. And by doing that, we shine the light of Christ, the brightest in the dark times, and we lead people to Jesus. We do it so they'll see our good works, not us, but see our good works and glorify our Father, which is in heaven. And y'all did that. Y'all showed up quickly, and we got out of here quickly. Jonathan Bailey, if you want to get with him, there's a slide up right now. It's got his name and his number on there. He is coordinating kind of the relief efforts from here. He's already got a list of things that we're going to get out on social media that you can bring, some specific things. And then we're going to have a disaster relief team also. So after the Tennessee disaster relief with the Tennessee Baptist goes in and assesses Monday what the jobs are, we've already got 2 skid steers lined up and several people that want to go. So we're all going to load up, those who are able to do it, and we're going to go to Waverly and work. So get your name on the list. If you want to give, give. If you want to give monetarily, you can get on the website. We'll be able to give there. There'll be a Waverly Relief tab there that you can give on the website. Anything that's given goes to help them. It won't stay with us. It'll go to First Baptist, and they'll know better needs. And so Pastor Scott Brown at First Baptist Church, pray for him. He's a dear brother in Christ, good man of God, and he's got a lot on his plate. They didn't have church this morning because they're just in the thick of it. If you want to bring stuff, donate money, that's good. But if you want to work on the team, get your name on the list, because as soon as we find out what our jobs are and what's necessary, those who said we want to be on DR teams, disaster relief teams, will send you a text message or give you a phone call, whatever you desire, and say we're going to meet here, here, have this, and we're going to go work. So Benton County took a ton of stuff there. The sheriff's department took 2 trailer truck loads. We took a bunch of people. If you're already over there, you live over there, you can take your stuff directly to First Baptist Waverly. They've got places to put all that. But most of all, pray that the God of heaven would help them through this time. There's 30-plus people that still haven't been found. There's many dead and many displaced. There's inside the city limits, there's nothing. So from one end of town to the other, it's destroyed. And so gas stations, supermarkets, homes, salons, whatever it is, it's gone. And so it's going to be a large amount of time that it takes to rebuild. And we have a lot of people from that area, so we're going to support them the best we can. And so don't call me, call Jonathan, okay? Because I'm going off what he says. And once he'll have all that information, Facebook Messenger, call him.
and he'll get you pointed in the right direction. I'm going to just be a worker, okay? I'm not heading it up. He is. I'm going to get in the skid steer and enjoy. I don't usually get to do stuff like that. 80% of my job is counseling and preaching. I don't usually get to be the hands on the ground, feet, things like that of Jesus. I'm excited that I'm going to go get dirty and sweaty this week and help some people, like kind of like we do in Honduras and other places. But be a part of that somehow, prayer, financially, gifts, or your back. Bring your back and let's do some work. Nehemiah chapter 8. We've been having a good time in Nehemiah, and we just thank the Lord for his word. After the wall was built, the people were counted. The Israelites settled back in their towns. It was the beginning of October, which would have been the Feast of Trumpets. The Feast of Trumpets is the first feast spoken of in Leviticus chapter number 23, verses 23 through 25. God gave it to the children of Israel as a complete day of rest. They would do the Feast of Trumpets, then the Feast of Tabernacles, then the Day of Atonement. God had this all planned out for them, and there was purposes for all of these things. At the Feast of Trumpets, they were to have a holy assembly and to read the Word of God. The day would be filled with the blast of ram's horn or the blast of trumpets. They were not to work, but they were to present special gifts unto the Lord. It was a day of rest, a day of sacrifice, and a day of celebration, getting ready for next the Feast of Tabernacles and then the Day of Atonement. On this day, Ezra the scribe, the priest, brought the book of the law, and the scriptures were read to the people. Let's read about it. In October, when the Israelites had settled in their own towns, all the people assembled with a unified purpose at the square just inside the water gate. They asked Ezra the scribe to bring out the book of the law of Moses, which the Lord had given Israel to obey. So on October 8th, Ezra the priest brought the book of the law before the assembly, which included the men and the women and all of the children old enough to understand. He faced the square just inside the water gate from early morning until noon, and he read aloud to everyone that could understand. All the people listened closely to the book of the law. Ezra the scribe stood on a high wooden platform that had been made for the occasion. To his right stood Mattathiah, Shema, Ananiah, Uriah, Hilkiah, Messiah. To his left stood Padiah, Mishael, Machachiah, Hashem, Hashbanadah, Zechariah, and Meshullam. Ezra stood on the platform in full view of the people. When they saw him open the book, they all rose to their feet. Then Ezra praised the Lord, the great God, and all the people chanted, "Amen, amen," as they lifted their hands. Then they bowed down and worshiped the Lord with their faces to the ground. The Levites, Yeshua, Bani, Sherebiah, Jamin, Akub, Shabbatai, Hodiah, Messiah, Kalita, Azariah, Jehozabad, Hanan, and Peliah, then instructed the people in the law while everyone remained in their places. They read the book of the law of God and clearly explained the meaning of what was being read, helping the people to understand each passage. Then Nehemiah the governor, Ezra the priest and scribe, and the Levites who were interpreting for the people said to them, "Don't mourn or weep on such a day as this, for today is a sacred day before the Lord your God." For the people had been weeping as they listened to the words of the law. Nehemiah continued, "Go and celebrate with a feast of rich foods and sweet drinks. Share the gifts of food with people who have nothing prepared. This is a sacred day before our Lord. Don't be dejected and sad. For the joy of the Lord is your strength." And the Levites too quieted the people, telling them, "Hush, don't weep, for this is a sacred day." So the people went away to eat and drink at a festival meal, to share gifts of food, and to celebrate with great joy because they had heard God's words and understood them. Father, these are your words, and now we ask you to help us understand them. God, may I present clearly as the priest and the scribes did to the people so they may hear. God, may the reaction be the same. May you cause us to be what you want us to be in the midst of your word and your spirit. May it change us forever, and may we become more like you because of this moment in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Ezra brought out the book of the law of Moses. It says all the men, women, and children that were old enough to understand were in the assembly that day. Now don't lose the importance of the word of God for all who can understand. Amen. Children, adults, old, and young. The word of God is good for all who can understand. Amen. No matter what age, no matter how old, how smart, whatever that is, don't lose the importance of that. Verse 3 says, Ezra was just inside the water gate. This was a wide spot. This was a court square. They couldn't do this where they should have probably done it, in the outer courts of the temple where they'd usually read the word. They had to get to a place where maybe up to 50,000 people could have gathered. Now, maybe not that many came, but a lot came, and there was up to 50,000 people in the town at that time. They got in a big spot, enough room for everybody to come. Hence, maybe why we have a big building and plenty of room for everybody to get here. And from early morning until noon, the scribe Ezra read aloud to everyone who could understand. All the people listened intently. They listened closely to God's word. Why? Because it is God's word. It was his word from his breath. All scripture is inspired by God, which means God breathed. It means the word of God. This is every time you hear the word of God, it is the breath of God. You are hearing God this morning. They listened closely. They listened intently because the voice of God was speaking through his word. Ezra stood on a high wooden platform. It had to be pretty high up in the air for that many people to be able to see him. Maybe kind of like a stage with six to his left and six to his right. Which I went to your left and right. Okay, I know mine. Okay, I know you probably saw that. I went the opposite direction, but I was trying to get that right for y'all. Okay, you ever had to tell somebody your other left? Go to the left and then they go the wrong way. Okay, never mind. Y'all got it. All right. They stood on this high platform. Ezra was preaching. Why did they put the high platform right in the center, up in the air, in the midst of all the people? Because the word of God has always got to be central to everything that we do. Why do our churches, why do we build them, and why do we put a pulpit right front and center? It's because the word of God, not worship, not fellowship, not Sunday school, not anything else, the word of God has to be central. The teaching and the preaching of the word of God has to be central. The reading aloud of the word of God, the explaining of the word of God has to be central to everything we do in the house of God. He stood where everybody could see him, high enough, and spoke where everybody could hear him. And when Ezra opened the book, verse 5 says, the people rose to their feet. Number one, they had a great reverence for the word of God. In this rebuilding or reestablishing of the walls of Jerusalem, of Israel, it wasn't just a physical work that God was doing. It was a spiritual work. When we look at this through lenses of how am I going to apply this to my life, we're looking at it in a spiritual nature. We're looking at how we're going to rebuild the spiritual things of God in my personal life, in my church, in my family, in my community. So when we saw them building this wall, they had a sword in one hand and a trowel in the other. They were laying those rocks. They were building those gates. They were doing all of that, but they were doing that to get to a place where they could solve, hear me, they could get to the root of the issue that caused the wall to be torn down. It was always a spiritual issue for Israel that caused them to always go into captivity. Persia and Babylon and Philistia and all those other places that attacked Jerusalem. All of their enemies were always coming against them. And the times that Israel and Judah and Jerusalem were destroyed, it was because God saw the sin of Israel and allowed those people to come in and do that. It was the reason was sin. The reason is sin. The reason the wall tore down is sin. The reason the things that are going on in their life is because of sin. But they still had a great reverence for the word of God. I think about that a lot. Do we have a reverence for the word of God? Now, I don't ask you to stand when we read the Word of God, but a lot of churches I go to, the pastor says when he gets up to read or when the speaker gets up, however they do it, they say, would you please stand if you can out of reverence for the Word of God? How many of you have ever been to a church that says that? Anybody? And they do that just so there's the great importance. And we might start doing it. I don't know. We just haven't. We revere the Word of God, but that's never been one of my habits or one of the things I did. But I want to hold it in great regard and treat it with great respect. Now, most would say that the reverence for the Word of God is gone in the community or the societies we live in, right? Most would say the reason we're in the shape we are in America is because many years ago there was a great reverence for the Word of God. But I'm a glass half full guy, okay? Like most people have a full glass, they pour half of it out so they can complain that they only got a half left. But I'm not that guy. Half a glass is a glass half full. Like, I want to see God move. I want to see God save people. I want to believe the best of everybody. I want to believe that God's still moving, God's still working, God's still saving people. And I want to tell you a good story about our community today that's going to lift your faith in humanity and what God is doing around us. This week, the coach at the junior high, Coach Jamie Reynolds, I thank God for him. He asked me to come and do devotions for the junior high team. I've been the FCA chaplain for the high school or the junior high now since 2004. I've done through Coach Ward, through Coach Blow, and now I'm at the junior high with Coach Reynolds. It's such a blessing to know that those coaches want the Word of God in their locker rooms and in their kids. In a world that's saying no to the Word of God, here at Camden, they still say yes to the Word of God. I said, absolutely, I'll be there. I'm there. I don't care. My son's an eighth grader, but I don't care if he's not there or not. I went to the high school for years just because of the opportunity. Now, it was Wednesday evening, ready for devotion. 40, 50 kids, coaches, and junior high boys. Y'all ever had any junior high boys around you? They're just wild as buck. You know what I'm saying? They stink like a herd of goats. I mean, it's terrible when you go in there. I don't wear a mask. I ain't scared of corona. I just can't handle the smell, you know. It's terrible. But they were sitting there, all of them in their chairs, their coaches standing up, listening to the Word of God. I start speaking about the Word of God, and I've got their full attention. I mean, I tell them about me. I tell them what I've done. Now, listen to me. I don't tell them all that I've done, okay? That's not good for junior high boys. If you have old war stories, do not tell them in front of your children because they want to be like mom and dad, and they're going to go do or try to do what you did. Get that out of your system before your kids are big enough to understand, okay? Because those things don't help. And kids are born in sin. They're not born in righteousness. When you talk about sin, they gravitate towards it, not away from it. You got to be careful. I didn't talk about all the things I did, but I talked about how I was in junior high and how I was 6 years old and said I got saved, but I didn't. And I got baptized. And then I was 13. I was in junior high. I said I got saved and baptized, but I didn't. There was no fruit of repentance. And every time I go, the first devotion of the year is how to get saved. I'm not a devotioner. I'm a preacher, all right? And I'm not a self-help, good talk, pat you on the butt, let's go kind of guy. That's not who I am. Let's talk about the Word of God, something that makes a difference, the blood of Jesus Christ. So I'm talking to these junior high kids, and them boys, they're looking at me, and I said, do you know who Jesus is? I said, what did Jesus do for you? Every one of them said, he died on the cross. Kids, I said, okay, praise. I mean, I was excited. They were more excited than a 9:30 service on a Sunday. I promise you, they were in it. They were pumped up. I said, I'm preaching by this time. I'm pointing, doing all this, and I'm yelling like a football coach, and we're excited. I said, why'd he die on the cross for your sin? I mean, why'd he die on the cross? They said, for our sin. They're like doing this for our sin. I'm like, yeah, for our sin. You know, and I'm like, 40 junior high boys, they know the God. I said, and on the third day, what happened? We're excited. He came back from the grave. I'm like, yeah, you know, charge the field, you know. You know, I'm just so pumped up. And I just tell them, now you have to believe in what Christ has done and be saved. God will forgive you of your sins, cleanse you from all unrighteousness, give you his Spirit, and you will be his child. And look, it don't matter if you win on the football field. It just matters that you win in eternity. And with Christ, we win. Amen? I want to tell you, all is not lost. When you think there's no reverence for the Word of God and nobody's reading the Word of God and nobody's worshiping God, always remember that there's still a whole bunch of them that haven't bowed their knee to Baal. They're not kissing the idols. They're not out and over here worshiping other God. They're still parents. They're still the Bible Belt. They're still churches. They're still preachers. They're still young men of God. And one day those 40 young men, I believe, I want God to save them. Amen. God to fill them with His Spirit. And one day they'll be the ones standing right here with all of us, proclaiming the Word of God for all of us to rebuild the spiritual things in our community. I get it. The world's in bad shape. I get it. All this stuff it's bad. I complain, but they're still good because there's still God, and His mercy endures forever. Believe in what God is doing in the good things. Their reverence turned into worship. Verse number 6, reverence equals worship. Reverence is a synonym for worship. I try to look up synonyms for something, and I try to get it alliterated because it's easier to remember. And I always look up these words, and it's amazing to me that when I look them up, they're the same word. It's worship and reverence. Reverence is a synonym, vice versa. And Ezra the priest begins to declare in verse 6 the greatness of God through His word. Then Ezra praised the Lord, the great God, and all the people begin to say, amen, amen, amen. What were they saying? They were saying, yes, that's true. Yes, that's right. You know, that's why a preacher shouldn't have to talk anybody into saying amen. When he reads the word, when the word is read, the people ought to be moved by the Spirit of God Himself and just say, amen, that's right. That's right. We believe this is who God said. Now listen, they hadn't lived right. They had been in a mess. They had neglected the Word of God. They had gotten away from the Word of God. They'd been doing their own thing. But when they got back to the Word of God, the Word was revealing who God was to them. He was revealing everything. That's how God reveals Himself to us, is through His Word. So when you hear God is good, you say amen. When you hear God is just, you say amen. When you hear God's a God of wrath, you say amen, because you know that the perfect revelation of God is in His Word. And when you are perfectly revealed who God is, it moves you in the Spirit that God has put inside of you. See, these people didn't have the Spirit of God in them. The Spirit of God dwelled in the Holy of Holies. The Spirit of God dwelled where He wanted to dwell. He went from here to there, to this person, to that person. There was a point A to point B, and God used it until the time the Holy Spirit come to come into all believers, as He needed the Holy Spirit in certain places, certain people at certain times to do certain things. But you, my friends, you always have the Holy Spirit. When you are saved and the Word of God is read, I don't know, mothers, I don't know what this is like, but this is kind of what I think it's like, okay? How many of you mothers remember when you had a child in your womb and that child would move? You remember that? That flutter, that fell. I had my wife like butterflies sometimes, but then it got to be like a punch in the ribs at the end, you know? I feel like that's God through the Holy Spirit. When His Word is read, there's something inside of it that's going, amen. Praise God. Glory to the Father. This is truth. There's something inside of you. His name is the Holy Spirit that causes, when the Word of God is read, for you to shout, amen, amen. And simultaneously, I like this, they lifted their hands. Why? Because the Word of God shows you the necessity of God in your life. And like a little child who's coming to his father and mother saying, oh, I need you. I need you. Oh, help me, God. You're sitting here going, yes. Listen, this is not a sign. This is not a show. When people do this, when the Word of God is written or read or sang, they're just declaring their utter dependence on a holy God. That's what this is. God, help me. God, please. I'm down here on the ground, flat on my back, useless. I am no good. I can't get to you. Oh, God, come to me. I can't keep this law that I'm reading. I am condemned. Oh, God, I need you, Father. Come to me and help me with hands lifted in the New Testament even. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 8. In every place of worship, I want men to pray with holy hands lifted up to God, free from anger and controversy. This is worship. When God moves us in our spirit, it moves us in our flesh. God wants some worshipers. We need worshipers moved by God's Spirit to exalt God's presence within the midst of His people. We need, and these might not even be words, we need ameners. You get it? We need people who say, yes, Lord, that's true. Amen. We need hand lifters. We need bower downers, because it wasn't just amen, amen, good time. But then they bowed down and worshiped it. And as they read and began to explain all that was going on, see, they didn't just get up here and read the word and say, good luck. You know, it doesn't do any good if I preach and you don't understand. Amen? It does no good. I can use all these big words and all this stuff and all these phrases and all this stuff, but if I can't get it to where you can understand it, it is no good. We are wasting our time. Ezra read the word, and all these other people said, do you understand? Do you understand? Do you understand? Let me help you understand. Well, when they finally understood, what happened? God's plans and purposes were revealed, and they began to weep. They began to weep. It caused them great anguish because it revealed God to them. They saw how holy He was. They saw that they had broke His law because they'd been living any way they wanted to live. And they began to weep. They were reverenced the Word of God. They worshiped. They began to weep, but God said, no, listen to me. There'll be a time of weeping. There'll be a time on the Day of Atonement for sackcloth and ashes. There'll be a time for repentance. But this is not the day of repentance. Verse number 10 says that it is time to rejoice. Nehemiah continued, go and celebrate with the feast, rich foods and sweet drinks. Share the gifts of food with people who don't have anything. This is a sacred day before our Lord. Don't be dejected and sad, for the Lord is your strength. The joy of the Lord is your strength. I tell you this morning, there's a lot going on around us, and there's a lot of sin, and there's a lot of hurt, but at some point you're going to have to decide to not let those things around you affect the joy that God has put in you, and let the joy of the Lord. There's got to be some days where we celebrate the goodness of God over all the things in the world that are going on. There'll be a day to hang our heads in repentance, but there's also days to go and celebrate, as Solomon said, to eat, drink, and be merry, to rest, relax, and enjoy, to share food and meals with each other. Sacred days to not be dejected and not to be sad, for the joy of the Lord is our strength. See, the law condemned them. They heard it. They wept. But the only, listen to me, this is what you got to get in your head. The only reason God ever condemns is so He can save. You listening to me? When God gives you the law, it's not to destroy you completely, but it is to destroy your flesh. So that you'll see your need for the Spirit and get saved. The only reason God ever says you're bad is so He can bring you to righteousness. He didn't come to destroy you. Listen, the whole point of 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 9, it says, God is not slow concerning His promise of return, but is long-suffering to all of us, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. He only tears down. He only calls weeping to come upon us. He only cause condemnation so that He can rebuild us in the way that He wants us to be, righteous through His Son, that we might rejoice all of our days in the joy of the Lord. That's our strength. The joy of the Lord is your strength. Waverly's destroyed, but you can't go over there with your head hung low because it's destroyed them. It's not destroyed you. With the joy of the Lord in your heart and the strength of your body, we go over there with the light of Christ, rejoicing that we're going to be able to help them through this tragedy in their life. Every day is not a day of sadness. Every day is not a day of gladness. But this day was a day of great joy because the joy of the Lord was their strength. What great joy comes from hearing the word of God and understanding it than doing what we have to with the understanding he's given us. There is a day to mourn, but it is not today. Today we're going to celebrate the goodness of God. Every head bowed and every eye closed. There's a song that's going to play that is called The Goodness of God. You've heard it. We've sang it. It's a song about how God has come after us, chased after us, moved in our lives, brought us to a place where we can know him and experience him. First, I would say this. If you're not saved, today is the day of salvation. If you're not hardened your heart, if you feel in yourself your heart being moved towards God by the word today or by his spirit. If you know God's calling you to himself, then I want you to ask him to save you today. I want you to ask him to forgive your sin and cleanse you from all unrighteousness. Through faith, that's the way you get saved. For by grace through faith, would you ask him for forgiveness? Would you ask him for his Holy Spirit? Would you ask him to be your Father? For with the heart man believes unto righteousness, with the mouth confession is made, which results in your salvation. Today Christ will save you. He died on the cross, was buried, and was resurrected on the third day to give you salvation. Today he will save you if you will ask him to. He will save you from your sin unto himself. Secondly is this, is there anybody here that's saved who will just come praise God for how good he is? It's not a day of weeping. It's not a day of mourning. But would you come down here today, get on your face before God for just a few minutes, and just say, God, you are good, and your mercy endures forever. You have blessed us. And as I begin to pray right now, would you come to this altar and just worship him? Father, in Jesus' name, thank you for the ones that are in this room, God. Thank you for the ones you're going to save in this room, God, and change their lives forevermore. And thank you for the saved people right now that are just going to rejoice in you. Lord, there'll be a day for mourning, but this isn't today. Today's a day to bless your name, the holy name of Jesus, the name above all names, the only name under heaven given among men whereby we can be saved, the Son of God, exalted to the right hand of the Father, who's been put over all things, who is our Savior and Lord, whose Spirit resides within us. We praise you for that. There's people coming right now just to worship him. How good is he? With every breath that I am able, oh, I will see. How good is he to us, church? Even when we've been outside of his will, when the walls have been torn down, when we've run away from the word, how good is he? Look at how he's restoring your families, restoring your hearts. Look at how he's going to restore this community and the ones around us. How he's going to use you for his glory. How you're going to be the hands and feet of Christ. How he's never left you. He's never forsaken you. He's always been with you. How he will always be with you to the end of the ages, throughout all eternity. You are in Christ and Christ in you. He is the hope of glory. He is the only hope of us going to glory. Christ himself, the one who spoke the world into existence, has become your Savior. The Father loved you enough to send the Son. How good is our God? In the midst of all that's going on in the world, how good is our God? Oh, the grace that he has given to all of us and the mercy. Thank you, Jesus. Your glory. People still praying. You come. Whatever you do, don't leave here today without telling God how good he is. how wonderful he is.
All my life you have been
faithful.
All my life you have been.
Every head bowed and every eye closed. I'm going to read. I'm actually going to pray. I'm going to pray Psalm chapter 3 over us. We're going to trust the Lord. Oh Lord, we have so many enemies. So many are against us. Many are saying, God, you will never rescue us. But you are Lord, you are our shield. You are our glory. The one who lifts our head. And we cry out to you, and you answer us from your holy mountain. We lay down and sleep, yet we wake up in safety, Father. For you are watching over us, and we are not afraid of 10,000 enemies, though they surround us on every side. Arise, O Lord, and rescue us, and slap all our enemies in the face. Shatter the teeth of the wicked. Our victory comes from you, O Lord. May your blessings fall upon the people that you call by your holy name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Hi, good morning, and welcome to Missionary Grove. We're so glad that you all chose to be here with us today. If this is your first time visiting, we hope that you've enjoyed it, and we would like to ask all first-time visitors to please go online to missionarygrove.com and fill out our MGBC connection card to tell us a little bit about yourselves. Also, first-time visitors, don't forget to stop by our Welcome Center where we have a very special gift waiting for you. MGBC continues to grow, and we are very excited about what God continues to do here in our church and through us in our community. With this growth comes the need for volunteers. We have several capacities in which you can serve. We are in need of a special needs ministry leader or van drivers for Wednesday night youth. We have several areas that we do need volunteers, and if you feel that the Lord is leading you to serve, then we would like to encourage you to please contact our connections coordinator, Mrs. Maddie Pierpoint. Thank you all again for being here with us at Missionary Grove today. We hope that you'll join us again next week. Please remember to share hope through the love of Jesus. God bless.
Amen. Let's stand up and be dismissed. Remember, get with Jonathan Bailey. Let's be the hands and feet of Christ. I mean, it's as simple as wash towels and hand towels and toiletries and hygiene products and simple things, bars of soap, things that... Or honestly, underwear, socks, things that we don't think about, that they don't have any of. And let's really show out, not for the name of Missionary Grove, but for the name of Jesus Christ on the earth. Amen. Working together for the glory of God. Sign up for disaster relief teams. If you got a, like me, you got a, well, I got a weak back and a weak mind. I'm going to just have to do something different. But if you got a good back, sign up. We're going to get some things going. And don't forget to give your offering when you leave. And I'm not used to dismissing, so you get to see me again. Most of the time, somebody else does. But God bless you. Thank you for being here. And invite somebody with you back next week. Father, we thank you for this group of people that are given to you, God. God, I pray you use them for your glory in this community and the ones that surround it. Thank you for giving us a day to rejoice and lifting us up in our spirits that we might see the goodness on the earth that you've given us. God, we praise you that right now we're going to leave. But the joy of the Lord is our strength, and go into the communities that you've planted us in, that the lost may be saved, and that everything might look more like your kingdom. We thank you for giving us the opportunity to work in your kingdom. We bless your name right now. In Jesus' name, amen. Go in grace, and we'll see you soon.